Well, I think we actually do have Luke Hughes of Nesson now joining us. Dave's going to go ahead and put him on. But just to kind of go off your point before we put Luke on, Mark, is that sometimes you just got to swallow the whistle, just like in the NBA. You know, there are certain times where late in the game you just got to let it go. So, you know, that's something that was very interesting on that end. Now we have joining us from Nesson.com officially Luke Hughes. Luke, are you there?
Oh, yeah, yes. Sorry about the wait, bro.
No, it's all right.
Well, Luke, before you got here, we were talking about the penalty that was called on Chris Jones that basically killed the Pats' chances at that comeback win and allowed Nick Folk the eventual game-winning field goal. Now, this is something that has happened several times this year in the NFL where guys from the second level have pushed guys into the pile, and it also happened a couple times during that game. Did you feel it was a little bit of an inappropriate time for the officials to kind of blow the whistle and throw out the flag on that play that eventually decided the game?
Yeah, you know, I mean, I think it was definitely the right call. It's a hard pill to swallow for Patriots fans, you know, just to hear that and to accept it. You know, especially when it did cost you an opportunity. It looked like Brady was pretty ready on the sideline. You don't know what's going to happen. So, you know, you can't really say that it cost them a win necessarily. But, yeah, I mean, it's frustrating when you see that it happened so much during the season and different games and the Patriots game against the Saints. I know that Chris Jones did the exact same thing on a field goal that the Saints were kicking. So, you know, you kind of see where, you know, the trend had originated, you know, throughout the season, and that they were supposed to be calling it, but they weren't. So it's definitely a frustrating, you know, element to the game, and you can't really blame the officials since it was the right call. But I think that the timing was poor. You know, just if you're going to call it, maybe call it on a field goal in the fourth quarter or call it in the first quarter or, you know, at any other time. But if the NFL really wanted to make a statement, they obviously did. And, you know, now everyone's aware of the rules. So you never know really where these things stem from. Maybe they're saying, you know, wait for a you know, prime time in the game to really get this thing firmed in as a rule and that everyone's, you know, well aware of it.
Hey, Luke, so New England, they just re-signed defensive end Andre Carter. What do you see his role being on the defense, and how do you think he might impact the defensive line?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a pretty big get for them. You know, you don't know really where he's at right now. It seemed like at the end of the year last year, he was really coming together in Oakland and he was starting to get back into solid form. But you're talking about a guy who's 34 years old. You know, he's been in the league 12, 13 years. So, you know, there's a lot of miles on those tires. So you can't really expect too much. But coming in halfway through the season, you get 9 games out of him. You know, I think that he can be kind of that third down pass rusher, the role that Mark Anderson played a couple years ago and really excelled in. You know, I think he can help out with some of the depth. You know, you have the opportunity now to move Chandler Jones over onto the inside a little bit if you want to play him there, fill in at the defensive tackle, and, you know, you can bring a reliable guy in, you know, Andre Carter in to fill the outside void. So I think it'll definitely help with a little bit more of the pass rush. I mean, Chandler Jones and Rob Ninkovich have been doing a great job, but it also offers some versatility for what they're going to do inside.
The Patriots, they've always been a team that's sort of kicked it into a second gear during the back half of the season. But this year, it kind of seems like maybe what you see is what you get. Do you think that this is the brand of football that we're going to see from the Pats, or do you think we might see them reach that second gear in the back half of the season?
Well, I mean, you know, as the season goes on, they always tend to gel together. The big problem now is that, you know, you're relying so much on your defense early in the season, and you lose a few key pieces. You don't really know when Aqib Talib is going to be fully healthy. He was probably the biggest playmaker on your defense this year. You know, and you don't really know how the interior defensive line is going to hold up against the run. It didn't look too good against the Jets last week. So, you know, you really got to figure that out. But, you know, I think that, you know, they're going to develop. The offense is definitely starting to come together. You see spurts. You see them, you know, really come together where Tompkins and Dobson are getting on the same page with Brady at times. But, you know, there's still a learning curve to be had. And I think that the more experience they get, not only in practice, but on the field, and then you get healthy with guys like Amendola really getting back up to speed, Rain coming back. I mean, I think you're really going to see them start to flourish as, you know, week 11, week 12, week 13 really rolls around.
Yeah, so, Luke, Mark Loisel here. Miami's defense allows 269 passing yards per game, 25th in the NFL. Is this the week Tom Brady gets back on track?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's definitely an opportunity for it. I mean, you're talking about he was going up, you know, last week against, you know, some elite corners. Obviously, Cromartie shut down Tompkins. You know, they had some good safeties back there. They also get some good, you know, pass coverage from their linebackers. I'm talking about the Jets here. So, you know, I mean, you're up against a pretty staunch opponent there. And now you come over and you got, you know, Brent Grimes and then, you know, pretty much a bunch of misplaced parts covering in Miami. So I think that there is an opportunity here for, you know, a guy like Dobson. Keep calling him Dobkins. I'm not sure why. you know, it's a combination of the two. But, you know, for Dobson to really get open, he's been creating a lot of space for himself. And I think that this is an opportunity where Brady's really not going to feel as much pressure. You know, maybe the offensive line steps it up, you know, a notch or two. And he's able to really get comfortable back in the pocket and find him when he's over the middle. You don't really know what Danny Amendola's status is going to be, if he's really over that concussion yet or not. But if he is, then I think that that's a great option. As well as Julian Edelman. I mean, everyone seems to just be overlooking him because of, you know, the emergence of some of these rookies and, you know, Gronk coming back. But Edelman is still playing a big part in this offense, and I think that he could really play a big part in the slot this week.
Yeah, so speaking of pressure, in the aftermath of Ryan Tannehill getting sacked 26 times this season, the Dolphins went out and traded for offensive tackle Brian McKinney. Will the Pats signing of Andre Carter with the rest of the defensive line, do you think the Pats will be able to get the quarterback against the Dolphins this Sunday?
Yeah, I mean, they obviously showed a lot of pressure against Geno Smith last week as well. It seemed like, you know, he was really bothered, especially in the second and third quarter, and even down the stretch there. Chandler Jones has been getting incredible pressure off the edge all season, and even on the interior when he's moved over. Same thing with Rob Ninkovich. I mean, you know, he's really creating a lot of pressure. He's not really piling up the sacks quite as well, but I think they have a solid core in there. I mean, even Chris Jones, I mean, he's up to, what, 4.5 sacks already, and he's only played, you know, 4 or 5 games. So there are some guys who can really get after the quarterback, and Carter will certainly help that. Again, like you said, you know, Tannehill's been sacked, you know, 26 times already, and it doesn't really seem like things are really going to get better. Brian McKinney is going to come in, and, you know, he might provide a bit of an upgrade over Tyson Klebo, but how much, we're not really sure. You know, he doesn't really seem like he's on the top of his game. He's not at that all-pro level like he used to be, or even where he was at the end of last season. So I think that, you know, there's definitely an opportunity for them to really create some pressure, maybe force some turnovers. Tannehill's been really good with the ball this year, been very careful with it, but I think, you know, you start pressuring him and really hitting him and throwing some licks on him, I think, you know, he'll probably throw some wobbly passes.
All right, Luke, on a more humorous note, on Nesson.com, you had a top 10 gallery of Mayor Menino's most awkward moments. So we were all talking about the flub that he had with the Red Sox in the World Series Cup yesterday. So before we let you go, we just want to know, what is your favorite one of all time?
Oh, man, I mean, there's so many that are great. And, I mean, I've got to say, I think that, you know, at a certain point, you know, it had started out pretty, you know, pretty naturally for him. It was just, you know, some mess ups, and I think that over time maybe he started to hone in on it a little bit, you know, PR staff saying, you know, let's get this let's get this out there, let's fool around a little bit. Yeah, exactly. You know, it's the fun stuff, and it's making him more likable. My favorite moment, honestly, was that, you know, the Veritech splits the uprights. It seems so honest and so innocent. You know, it didn't seem like there was any force there. Seems like now, you know, with the Gonk and Weckler and whatever you're getting,
right.
You know, there's a little bit more of a force behind it, but the Veritech through the uprights just kind of killed me.
All right, well, Luke Hughes of Nesson.com, we really appreciate you taking the time, man.
Yeah, great talking to you guys. Have a good one.
All right, take it easy. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back here on the Sports Blast, 1460 WXBR.